enjoyed meeting all of you that I've met so far. I'm looking forward to meeting the rest of you. So as Felix was saying, I started off actually in computer vision, and now I do more human vision, which is kind of a mix of computational modeling and behavioral experiments. And there's several sort of main differences between computer vision and modeling human vision, which are relevant a bit to this talk. One of which is that, as EJ alluded to, we tend to prefer simplicity when at all possible, and we give it up when we need to, but we'd like to have some simple stuff. It's much more of a computer vision thing to take, you know, the three best models and combine them and see if you can do better, and that's very much not what you hope to do in human vision. And another thing is that the thing I often tell potential students and so on is that in computer vision, you're often trying to do the best you possibly can with your algorithm. And in human vision, it's much more that if the human does something poorly, I want the model to do something poorly. And as a result, one of the things is that we really like places where the human does, it seems, surprisingly poorly. And that's because that really tells us something about what's going on. And that's some of what I'm going to talk about today. The slightly modified version of that is that with the work that we're doing now, the interesting bit is actually trying to get a model that both explains the places where you do poorly and the stuff that you're good at. And that has turned out to be kind of a challenge over the last bunch of decades. Okay, so there's big puzzles in vision, of course, but here's the one that interests us right now. When you look at a scene like this, you feel like you get a very rich subjective experience of the scene. You know a lot about what's going on in that scene. And in fact, there's some data to back this up. You can very quickly get what's called the gist of a scene, what kind of a scene it is, the rough layout, and things like that. And Fei-Fei Li and others have shown you, in fact, get a great deal of rich information about that scene if you ask them afterwards to explain as much as they can. Just to give you an example here, I can flash up a scene for you, and you'll see quite a lot about it. Are you all ready?
Yeah.
What kind of a scene?
Mountains.
Clouds in the sky.
Lake.
Desert heat.
I thought I had it.
It's a subway station.
I copied over those slides incompletely, obviously. And I'm not sure. Can I go back and show you? Probably not quickly. All right. But anyway, yes, it's a mountain scene, yada yada. You got a lot of the details right. And in fact, I can even show you them to you very quickly in sequence and ask you, if I tell you in advance in particular, you know, tell me if there's a subway station in this sequence, you could do it even if there's only like 17 milliseconds per image. Molly Potter has shown this. So see if you see a subway station.
Yeah.
And in fact, you could probably even say, you know, it looked a lot like this. You don't simply know the category. You know a lot about what it looked like, right? So it seems like you get this great rich percept, and even very quickly. However, observers do very poorly when you probe them experimentally on the details of that scene. And one way that we do this is using change detection or change blindness experiments. How many people know about change blindness? Could you just... Okay, so a decent number, but definitely we can use a demo. So one way that people do this is they show two images that are slightly different, and there's a gray screen in between. The purpose of the gray screen is to remove any motion transients that would tell you, that would make it obvious what the change was between the two scenes. Raise your hands if you see the difference between the two scenes. I'll give a little more time for those who don't. Anyhow, people tend to be quite bad at this situation, although not always. It depends on the image pair, et cetera, et cetera. And this has been interpreted to mean that even though you feel like you've got all the details, you apparently aren't very good at the details. Because if you were good at the details, why wouldn't it be easy to tell that one of the details is changing? People still don't get it any? Yes? Look over to the left. Do you see it now? Yes, no. Box appearing and disappearing? Yeah? Anyone still doesn't see it? Some people are still really frowning. Right here. It's there, it's gone, it's there, it's gone. See it? Okay. All right, so that seems to imply that you feel like you have this rich percept, but you're poor at the details. There are similar stories. People do these set perception experiments where they show you a whole set of items, and then they take them away, and then they ask you things like, you know, either what's the mean orientation of the set, or which one is tilted more to the left, this set or this set. They ask you things like that. You do mean size, all sorts of things like that. People are actually quite good at it, even for fairly high level kinds of processing. People have done experiments where you're pretty good at like the mean facial expression. Like, is this audience sleepy? Right? People are good at that. But on the other hand, if you ask them particularly about a particular item in the set, people are quite poor. So again, suggesting you have some kind of rich percept of like the thing as a whole, but you seem to be bad at these details. And another kind of paradigm that's been used to demonstrate that you're bad at the details is visual search. You seem to lack the details needed to at least sometimes find your keys, right? And everyone see the keys? Okay. And of course, you know this from your normal life, but it's also true just in experiments in the lab. In the lab, people tend to do simpler displays with more similar items here. So everyone, I want you to, you're going to do an experiment here, get ready to clap. Clap when you see the O in this display. Okay, you ready? Okay, so that was pretty easy, right? And in fact, probably a lot of you also noticed that there's a red X, even though I didn't even tell you to look for that. But sometimes search is quite hard, just like with the keys. So now you're going to clap when you see the orange square. Ready? There's theoretical reasons why if you have a longer RT, you also have more spread in the RT, as you have all nicely demonstrated. And anyway, people have done a lot of experiments on this. And again, the idea is that if you were really good at all the details of the scene, why is it so darn hard to find the target? The target's perfectly discriminable when you look right at it from the other items in the display. If this were all about, if this were just a mere discriminability when you look at the item, they should all be easy, but they're not. That implies you're not so good at the details. Okay? And the general pattern of at least the first bunch of experiments on search is that if I tell you to search for something like a red item among green, very easy. This is true for other, what people have described as basic features, okay? A very tilted item among verticals, things like that. Those kind of searches are easy. It's considerably harder if you have to search for a conjunction of features. So here you're searching for a white vertical among things that are either white or vertical, but not both, and that's harder. And it's even harder than that if you have to search for some kind of configuration of the features. Here you're looking for a T among L's, so it's the particular configuration of the vertical bar and the horizontal bar. That is more difficult. And in particular, this is very efficient. It doesn't really even matter how many items there are in the display. You're very fast. To first approximation, doesn't matter. And whereas these get harder the more items you add to the display. All right. And the search story in particular had seemed to provide an explanation for what might be going on, like why you're so bad at the details. Treisman and Gillade and later others argued that essentially the reason why the search is so often hard is that you have limited capacity. And in particular, the kind of limited capacity you have is limited access to higher level processing. And one way of thinking about this, the way that they were thinking of it, is it's almost like a train station, right? You have like maybe one track in the train station that goes from east to west. But you've got a bunch of train tracks maybe that are coming into the station. And somehow you've got to get the train that you want to get on into the station. So you switch the tracks and only one train comes in, and then later only some other train comes in. If you want to process that boat, for instance, and find out what it is, something that they call attention selects the item, sends it through the train station, and then you get to do higher level processing, recognize it's a boat, and so on. Okay? And so the idea is that you need this selective attention to an item to get higher level processing. That means you need it to see it fully. The reason why the hard search tests are hard, according to this reasoning, is that you need it to bind the features, like vertical and horizontal, or vertical and white. You need attention in order to do those things. And the reason why the search for red among green is easy is that without attention, you get pre-attentive information. And that pre-attentive information is these basic feature kind of maps. So another way this is often drawn is like this. Without attention, you get, you know, a blue map and a yellow map and a red map is where things are, those colors, say. And you get a horizontal and a diagonal and a vertical. But you don't get you can't combine them without attention. If you want to know that the line is red and vertical, this thing that rotated looks like, if you want to know that's red and vertical, then you have to apply attention to that location, and then you can bind those together and recognize them, okay? All right, so this is known as early selection because the idea is that you don't get much processing before attention selects something and sends it through the train station, okay? All right, so if that's what's going on, then it suggests that vision is really quite poor without attention. And it seems like the situation for human vision is even worse than that because attention itself appears to have low capacity. So people do these multiple object tracking experiments where you show some number of items, you flash, say, four of them in a different color, you say, track those, keep track of them. And it's like a shell game, right? You have to keep track of where the nut is under the shell. And so they all move in different ways, and at the end you have to select the targets that you think were the ones you were supposed to track. And based on this, they try to figure out how many items you can track at once, and what people often find is you can track about four. And so the claim is that you have essentially, you can attend to four things at once and track them in this way. That's a relatively limited capacity, so attention is limited capacity. And it also appears to have limited capacity in the sense of how many tasks you can do at once. That's sort of number of items, this is number of tasks. So people do these dual task experiments where they ask you to do some central task, T's or L's or both. While off in the periphery, you also do some other task, like whether that's an L or a plus. And you either do them individually or you do them both at once. People are often worse when you have to do two tasks at once. There's a cost to more than one task, implying again that attention is limited. And that all sounds bad enough, but then it's even worse than that, because you might think, okay, no problem. I can attend to this person, and then this person, and then this chair, and then this wastebasket, and so on, and I can just remember everything I've seen before, and I can build up a rich percept that way. But no, it seems that visual working memory is also limited. And so people do experiments like this, where they give you some number of items to study, then there's a delay, and they ask you about one of them. You don't know in advance which one. And again, they use this to decide how many items you can hold in memory at once, is usually how it's been thought of. And it looks like the working memory capacity is also only about four items. So this isn't going to help you build up that rich percept very much. All right. So this theory, again, just to reiterate, this suggests that you have poor vision without selective attention. Selective attention is limited. You can't fill in the details with memory, because that is limited, so it's not sounding so good, right? And there's all sorts of problems with this, but one of them is, how do you explain, the poor, on the one hand, explaining the poor performance reporting the details seems kind of obvious. It's easy to explain why performance is bad here. But how is it that you seem to get this rich percept of complex scenes? How is it you do so well with scene tasks and so on? And I think even more importantly, how the heck does real world vision work so well if this is what's going on? And there's a number of issues here, but one of them is, if your vision before you have attention is so poor, how are you directing attention so that you can get more details about the different objects and stuff? And I'll show you a little bit about what this looks like, and so that I can also talk about solution. I mean, you might start off looking at a scene, and you're currently fixating on the books and attending to the books so you can recognize that they're books. But everywhere else, you just have like a mess of low-level features and you don't know much about what's going on there. And someone says, find the mug. Well, so, what do? You just kind of randomly move your attention around until you find the mug. You're going to be pretty darn slow at finding the mug. And, someone might help you by telling you it's on the desk, but then that's kind of a chicken and egg problem, because if you don't, do you need to attend to the desk to know where the desk is? To know that it's a desk, you're going to have to move your attention around until you find the desk, and then it's a desk, etc. So that's kind of a problem. Now, someone could legitimately help you by telling you that it's brown, at which point it's believed that you can select certain features, simple features like all the brown stuff, in which case you might know the desk is somewhere down there. That might help you a little bit. But even if you can kind of work up to get doing the task you've been given of finding the mug, by doing all this, you still have this problem of how are you ever going to do things that weren't part of your task? Like, how are you ever going to notice there's a person sitting at that desk? Right? And yet, it's not hard to notice that there's a person sitting at that desk. All right. So, there have been a couple of explanations for how this works in the past. One of them is often referred to as attentional capture. And the idea here is that, you know, you're fine so long as you select the relevant stuff. How do you select things that aren't necessarily task relevant? Well, you sort of bootstrap things by, you can take that pre-attentive information and you can find within that those feature bands unusual or salient features. Those can lead you to select a new part of the scene. So for instance, you might select that basketball because it's an unusual color. That leads you to then recognize it as a basketball. You also can make use, as I hinted at with the brown desk, you can make use of some top-down knowledge about what the target looks like. And this actually can sometimes help you even do task-irrelevant things. So you might know that you're counting the passes of black basketball players, and so you select for black, and that allows you to get that basketball player and then recognize her as a basketball player. But it also, since it's kind of a crude top-down filter, might allow you to select by accident the gorilla who's walking through the middle of the scene, and therefore sometimes recognize that there's a gorilla and notice this unusual item that you're not expecting at all in the scene, right? But let's take a step back and think about this proposal for how things work, right? You're going to start off with some pretty bad, poor attentive information, and you're going to make up for that by being easily distracted by irrelevant shiny things, and by having some kind of crude top-down filters that capture useful stuff by accident, right? I think you will agree that this is perhaps no way to design a visual system. We walk around, we don't get killed. We have high-functioning visual systems. One could argue that it needs to be better than this, okay? All right. And then another class of theories has basically noticed that the selective processing that I talked about before, this basically this feature integration theory that Treisman and Jalabe came up with, that does a pretty good job of predicting the tasks that you're bad at, right? Because things that you can't do with pre-attentive information require this slow serial selection in order to do the task. But it doesn't do such a good job of the tests that you're good at, getting the mean of a set and getting the gist of a scene and stuff like that. And so a number of folks have suggested that maybe there's some other pathway that's not so capacity limited that does the extra stuff. It does ensemble processing, it does scene perception. And the idea here is, I mean, you might ask, why doesn't this just do vision? The idea is that it's not quite like what you might think of as normal object recognition happening in that pathway. That it's doing some kind of statistical processing or something like that, and that's what it allows it to get the gist of scenes and sets. And we're going to come back to that idea later in the talk. Okay. So the general plan here is I'm going to talk about more recent work that's trying to explain all these puzzles. And my main point is going to be that peripheral vision actually explains a lot of this puzzle. And as a result, because so many of the previous explanations had to do instead with selective attention, we're really going to have to rethink what attention means and where the capacity is limited and so on. All right. Okay, so let's start out just revisiting the evidence for this limited perception in vision. And here's a list of some of the ones I talked about before, but I'm going to start off just talking about change blindness and search. Okay, so you remember I showed you that thing and it flickered back and forth and the box appeared and disappeared and it was hard to see that? That's change blindness. And the idea behind change blindness was that the fact that it's hard to detect a change implies that there's little perception without attention. The idea is that change detection is so slow because you have to move this spotlight of attention around until you happen to land on a change, and then you can detect it. But until then, it's slow. And since attention is a limited resource, you're bad at this. But the question we want to ask is, could it instead be that peripheral vision is at least part of the explanation here? And the idea here is that, of course, we all know that peripheral vision is impoverished compared to foveal vision, especially where there's clutter. And so could it be that it's difficult to detect change, not because you're not attending to the change, but because you're not looking at the change, or not looking close enough to the change? And I'm going to talk later in more detail about the ways in which peripheral vision is worse than foveal vision, but for now, just introspect on it. I'm using the word peripheral vision here to mean everything outside of your rod-free fovea or foveola. That's the fovea. What I'm calling fovea is about the size of your thumb nail at arm's length. And you could just hold out your arm right now and, you know, try to see things outside of that, especially like way outside of that, like 20 or 40 degrees outside of that, and you'll see, I think, that your vision is just not so good out there in the periphery. And yet, as we'll come back to, it's very rich still. You get a lot of information out there in the periphery, right? Okay. So with change blindness, there are some hints that peripheral vision is a factor. I mean, first of all, wherever you're pointing your eyes, a lot of the scene is off in the periphery. You can easily imagine that you might not be able to see the details very well. Some folks have shown that if you fixate on or near a change, you're more likely to detect it. That sounds like peripheral vision might be involved. How likely you are to detect the change depends on how far away you are when the change first occurs. Sometimes observers seem to notice the change in the periphery, again suggesting that might be involved. And in fact, really salient changes, like big changes in color and stuff like that, people have shown you can detect them without ever fixating them, which again suggests peripheral vision might be at play. Okay. So here's how we wanted to get at this question of whether peripheral vision might be a lot of the explanation. We're going to play this game, and we'll do this in some other cases as well, where we're going to have people attend to a peripheral change, meaning, and we're going to measure how hard it is for them to see these changes off of the periphery. And we're going to ask whether or not that difficulty predicts how hard it is to see the change in the usual paradigm. So we started out by taking a bunch of change detection pairs from the literature and some others as well. And we just did the same kind of paradigm I showed you, where you this flicker paradigm, where you go image, blank, and you keep it on until people notice the change or give up like 2 minutes in or something like that. And you can measure how long it takes to detect the change, and also to some extent whether they ever detect the change. So that gives us an idea of just how hard it is, a measure of how hard it is to detect the change. And here's each symbol is a different change detection pair. We have different kinds of changes as indicated by the symbol shape. And you can see that based on both the number of correct detections and the time it takes you to detect the change, that there really is quite a range of how difficult change detection is, even though we often see the hard examples. We use the hard ones for demos, but there's quite a range. And the red symbols here are the ones that I then later use in later experiments. And by the way, I should mention, part of the reason I emphasize that these are change detection pairs from the literature is that I, of course, could have constructed an experiment in which peripheral vision would be the only factor in how well you detect the change, but I did not do that. These are the exact same change detection pairs that people have studied for years to make claims about attention and change detection and so on. All right, so once we get this baseline of how hard it is to detect changes, oh, unfortunately this is very low contrast, but I will point to things. We then tell people what the change is. We show it to them with no gradient in between so they can clearly tell what the change is. We make sure they know what the change is. They have to tell us what it is. And they know where it is. And then we show them one image from the pair and the second image from the pair. And then in the third interval, we show them one of the first two again. And their task is to say whether this one is the first one or the second one. And critically, we force them to fixate somewhere away from the change and at different distances to the change, okay? And so, first of all, attention was all you needed to detect the change, then they should just be super good at this task, right? Because they know what it is, they know where it is. We've made this task much easier than this standard paradigm. But we would expect instead, if it's peripheral vision, then it would depend on the eccentricity and that how hard the change detection was would depend on how difficult it was in the periphery. The data on this is very complicated. We get this complicated fit of here on the y-axis is the how well they do at that peripheral discrimination when they know what the change is. this is as a function of eccentricity, and then these are slices through the function that we fit to all the data. The different lines here are for different difficulty in the original Flickr paradigm, okay? So what you can first just see is that for the easy change detection pairs, like this line up at the top, it doesn't matter much how far away you fixate. You're pretty darn good. Up to 10 degrees, you can see the change, no problem. Whereas for the more difficult change detection, it drops quite precipitously when you move your eyes far from the change. And here's just an example. This is actually the easiest change detection in our set. Can people tell what the change is? Yes, I see at least some nods. It's a little far away for some of you, maybe, but there's a post here that appears and disappears, which, by the way, you've just done a change detection experiment, right? You can also put them side by side like a kid's puzzle and ask people to spot the differences. It's the same idea. And actually, some people have shown that you get essentially the same results by and large when you do that. Anyway, for one of the easiest, you can tell that it's pretty flat. It's pretty independent of eccentricity, the distance to your fixation. This is our hardest example, and it drops quite badly if you're looking away from the change. Does everyone see the change in the second case? Some people who are raising their hands have already seen this talk, but
I cheated by free fusing.
Yes, that's the problem putting them side by side. I have to put them up one above the other. Anyhow, this one is the horizon is shifting. Which in this small image looks like a small shift, but it's actually a pretty significant shift when you put them full size on the screen. Okay. And I just want to, again, make the point that we're trying to separate peripheral vision from attention here by having you attend and varying the eccentricity, varying the peripheral vision. And here, you're out at 6.25 degrees away from the change, and you're attending to it, and you know what it is, and it's still darn hard, right? Okay, so hard changes require closer fixations in order to discriminate them. So you can predict your performance in that Flickr paradigm that I showed you first, by looking at how hard it is to discriminate the changes in the periphery, at what eccentricity you start doing well. And again, this is even when you know where the changes are and so on. This implies that peripheral vision is helping to detect the changes, right? That you must to some degree be doing it in parallel across the visual field, because if you weren't, it wouldn't predict performance in the Flickr task, right? And also just again to point out that selection is not necessary or sufficient for detecting the changes. Okay. All right, so that's change blindness. What about search? And again, the idea with search was this is another way of writing the feature integration theory. You have some image input, you get to do some amount of parallel processing that extracts pre-attentive features, and then at some stage you have the serial selection. The thing that's selected gets access to higher level processing and recognition and so on. And so a lot of search experiments were thought of as trying to probe where in visual processing selective attention operates and what kind of processing can happen pre-attentively. And this was the story for decades in the human vision field. And yet along that time, there were some hints that peripheral vision was a factor nonetheless. And by the way, the original search people who thought about attention didn't completely ignore peripheral vision. They thought about things like the fact that you have loss of resolution in the periphery, but that's not all that happens in the periphery. And some of the work to better understand peripheral vision happened in the meantime. So in some sense, this wasn't their fault for thinking they had control for peripheral vision, but they hadn't done enough control. Marissa Carrasco in particular has demonstrated there's all sorts of eccentricity effects in search. How far away the target is from where you point your eyes has influenced us how quickly you can find it. She did this thing called M-scaling the stimuli, where you make the stimuli that are far from your fixation bigger, and that not only makes the search in some cases considerably easier, but it can even qualitatively change which tasks are easy and which are hard, which really suggests there's something interesting peripheral happening. We're going to hear from Bill Geisler in a day or two days?
Wednesday.
And he's done some really nice work looking at peripheral discriminability of gabors and noise and showing that you can predict all sorts of things about search based on that peripheral discriminability, how hard the search is, how many eye movements you make, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, there were various hints that search difficulties related to how easily you can peripherally discriminate the target in clutter, but these were just some very early steps. And so we really wanted to essentially go farther along this last point here. So similar to in the change blindness example, I had people attend to the peripheral change and measure how discriminable that change was. Similarly here, we're going to have people attend to a peripheral patch. That patch is either a target present patch here. Here the target is a T at some orientation among L's. And the target absent patch is an L among L's instead. And we ask them to discriminate in the periphery, is a given patch a target present patch or a target absent patch, and measure the difficulty of that. And when you do that, you actually find that that does a pretty darn good job of predicting search difficulty. So here, each one of these symbols is a different search experiment. The peripheral discriminability is along the x-axis. The y-axis is a standard measure of how difficult the search is. This is a slightly funny measure because higher is harder. So that's what the line tilts down. But you can see it's a pretty good fit, right? And this includes not only the standard search experiments that led to the development of the original feature integration theory, but also some cases that were problematic for that theory. Because people had found, for instance, that it was easy to search for a cube lit one direction and lit another direction. That didn't seem like it was the same kind of feature as color. And anyway, so it's a pretty good fit. And also, just to be clear on this, here, all your favorite phenomena in search are already present in peripheral vision. So you can attend to the periphery, and it's still hard to tell if there's a T or an L. So the lack of binding, if you will, seems to be a product of peripheral vision, not necessarily of a lack of attention. And similarly here, you can attend to the periphery, and you can't see it from this graph, but I'm just telling you, you make all sorts of illusory conjunction errors where you misreport whether something is white and vertical or black and vertical, and so on. And nonetheless, when you have a unique basic feature like color or an orientation or something like that, that information is quite well preserved in the periphery. The discriminability is quite easy. Okay? All right. So it looks like peripheral vision is, at the very least, a factor in change blindness and in search. Or put another way, at the very least, it was a confound in the experiments that people did on change detection and on search. But you might be asking, as I often get this question when I give these talks, so what? Why does it matter? We started off talking about whether vision is impoverished or not impoverished. You seem like you've got rich details, but then when someone probes you on the details, you're bad. What does it matter if you can't see something because you're not attending, or you can't see something because of peripheral vision? That sounds like in both cases, I just can't see something. But I would argue that actually it makes a big difference, and we'll get some hints of this later on. In the selective attention story, you have these substantial losses where you're not attending, right? You only get these basic feature maps. You don't get any binding or any higher level processing. And attention is highly limited. And I think a critical thing also is that for that unselected stimulus, you don't get any later processing, basically. No significant later processing. And if that's all true, then many tasks are just going to be impossible, okay? In the peripheral vision case, on the other hand, the lost information, in some sense, just happens to make these tasks hard. These particular choice of laboratory tasks are difficult because of the particular nature of peripheral vision. But potentially lots of information that we haven't probed in these experiments survives. And also critically, the processing can continue. You can do higher level processing on the information that remains. That's what we assume. And as a result, you could imagine that you could perform lots of tasks if this is the loss of information.
Can I ask a question? So I feel like maybe just to give the opportunity for the attention people to come back, I'm not sure if everybody would agree completely with this, like, early bottleneck view, attentive view that you've made. So, like, Shulhofstein and people like that with this reverse hierarchy view. I mean, I've never fully understood exactly what it is that he means, but it seems like people have been mindful that there are limits to this, you know, simple, early, broadband style selective attention story.
Yes, I think so. And some of that we're going to come back to later. I think the critical thing is if you think of this as early, then you come into these conundrums. And Shaw, for instance, thinks of it a lot of it as happening late, so he doesn't have the same problems, and and other people who have a theory that doesn't require so quite so strictly to have an early bottleneck don't have the same kind of vision.
Right. So it's not necessarily an attention versus peripheral vision thing. It could also
be this particular.
It's
this particular kind of early selection that I'm criticizing. The and in fact, I should maybe mention, since a fair number of you do some sort of physiology, that how behavioral people think of attention and how physiology people think of attention are very different. So I'm also not talking about necessarily how a lot of the physiology people. Okay. So I just said, let's go back just to the end of that. So potentially you can perform a lot of tasks, right? And so a big question should be, well, okay, what information does survive peripheral vision? What tasks can you do with that information? And so to understand that, we need to better understand peripheral vision. And I want to start by sort of debunking a few myths out there. And, fine, arguably you should never go searching for things on the internet and hoping to get anything sensible, but this is the kind of thing you tend to find on the internet. Peripheral vision has terrible resolution and no color vision. And they'll show you an image like this. I found this on Quora. Where you can see there's color only in this tiny little range, and things are very blurry and low contrast and everything off in the periphery, right? And there's, some truth to this, but these effects, especially with images like this, they're greatly exaggerated. And some of this is, I almost think of this as a tale of misunderstanding information visualizations like graphs. So here's one thing you probably have all seen. Have you all seen plots like this of cone density as a function of eccentricity? Anyone not seen plots like this? Often you'll find on the internet, or in this case, in vision science books, plots that look like this, and they'll say, oh my gosh, look how bad the acuity is in the periphery, right? And you've got tons of cones right here in the fovea, and then it really drops off precipitously as you go off into the periphery, right? But the problem here is that cone density isn't the right measure. Acuity refers to how close can I put two lines, and you can tell it's two lines instead of one line, okay? And that's going to have to do not with density. I mean, density is something like this. How many of these cones can you fit in a square millimeter, which is exactly what's over here. Density, I like to do sort of in terms of units, right? Density is like the number per millimeter squared, right? And the much more relevant for acuity is how closely spaced the cones are in some linear dimension, right? Because that's going to affect whether or not you see two lines or one line is how much they're spaced. And so that's millimeters. And if you sort of think it through, cone spacing is going to be something like proportional to 1 over the square root of the density, right? And so if you now take this plot and you take, 1 over the square root of that, then you get something that looks much less dire for peripheral vision. That gray bar down there is intended to be my plot of the change in cone spacing as a function of eccentricity. Now, of course, what should the y-axis be here? I've chosen to make it so that, 20 degrees here is the same distance as 20 degrees here. Maybe that's not quite fair. You can look at this little grown-up area here and see that this isn't really lying down there at zero. Things are going up as you go further out in eccentricity, but it's very small. The spacing is like 4 arc minutes way out there at 90 degrees eccentricity. So very, very, very close cone spacing. And people also, sometimes you see instead of this plot, so the cones now are that blue curve and the rods are the red curve here. And so we can say, well, how bad is color perception in the periphery? It's not quite as simple as that plot I just showed you, because you've got 3 cone types, and there's different kinds of connections between them, and so on. I mean, EJ just told us how complicated it is, right? This is a good follow-on. But a myth that you hear when you look at this plot, often it's plotted so you can't even tell that this blue line isn't down at zero. But the blue line is not down at zero. In fact, you know, it goes down to a nice solid, about 4,000 cones per square millimeter, even far out in the, quite far eccentricity. And so what you'll sometimes hear this claim that we don't really know the color that's out there, we just fill it in based on something like prior knowledge, or the fact that we already looked at the thing, so we know it's red, and then we look it away, we assume it's still red, so we imagine that it's red. But this isn't the case. I mean, first of all, people have, it turns out that the reality is basically color perception is pretty darn good. Pretty far out, so long as you give people big enough patches to look at. And what's shown here with these red, green, and blue curves is how big the patch has to be in degrees in order for your color judgments to be just as good as they are in the fovea, and you can see they can be quite small. And by the way, we also know this isn't just filling in, because people do good experiments, and they make sure that you didn't move your eyes, and you can't possibly know that it's red out there, so no one's filling in based on prior knowledge. All right, and here's another version of this. You know, I showed you that thing where they blurred it to make it look like, to show you what the loss of resolution looks like. Here's another example of that. You have an original image where your fixation is supposed to be on that plus. Here is an image that has been blurred to mimic the loss of resolution. And I want to be clear, this does not imply that peripheral vision is necessarily blurry. This is just we've removed the high spatial frequencies that in theory you couldn't see. And I think you'll agree that this is a pretty modest effect, the amount of loss of resolution here compared to here. And in fact, it turns out this is an exaggeration. They're using a Photoshop technique, and Photoshop, you can't turn the knobs any lower. So that's about a 4x exaggeration by my estimate. I think you could see that you could do just, you know, most tasks, this would be more than enough resolution to do the task. So loss of resolution can't be like the main thing in peripheral vision. Here I blown up the patches. So you can see they are different, right? But yeah.
So you know these polls are on the internet.
Yes.
There are these pictures where you have fonts of different sizes, like
yes.
An eye chart, but
yes.
Scaled up.
We're getting there.
Okay. All right.
All right. But again, to make matters worse, so this is the real, only slightly exaggerated, this is the original, and this is what you often see on the internet. So people crank it up, I think because, you know, if I can't presume to know what's in people's heads, but you can't see the blur very well here. So you increase the blur so you can see it, and that would be fine if you would cop to it, but instead what it usually says is something more like this. When you fix it at the respective centers of this image and the original, both pictures look equally sharp because the progressive blurring in the right-hand picture just matches the progressive loss of acuity in the left-hand picture and due to what's going on in the retina. So look at this. Do you think that when you're fixating in the middle, does it look as blurry as that one? No.
This doesn't make sense even if they were to match it, because it gets blurred twice, right?
Well, it's kind of blur, but yes, in general, I agree with you. I sort of feel like if they've already sold you on this idea that you're filling in color and you can't really see color in the periphery, in spite of the fact that you feel like you can see color in the periphery, they're now trying to see how far they can go with this and tell you that you don't see blur when you see blur. So this is what you want to see on the internet. As Alyosha has referred to, another version of this is you can look at the letter size that you need to read a single character off of the periphery. And this is the threshold letter size is measured by ANSYS. You'll notice that the letter size increases very slowly as you go off in the periphery. This is not a satisfying thing to look at because this is like the level at which you're like 70% correct on the letter, so it feels hard. But nonetheless, this looks the increase of the threshold looks very non-dramatic, right? It's going in eccentricity. If you really could read these letters at that size, you know, you could read a whole page of text without moving your eyes, but that's not true. And so perhaps because this one seems unsatisfying because they still seem so hard, instead people tend to show this, where now they've increased all the letters to be 10 times the threshold size. So now it seems like a more satisfying demo because they all do kind of seem equally easy to see. But the problem, of course, is that then people will look at this and say, look how quickly the letter size has to increase in the periphery. But that's, of course, because we just made the rate of increase 10 times what it actually is. And so you're exaggerating, again, how bad peripheral vision is. Okay? All right. However, you, as you well know, cannot read a paper text without moving your eyes. And that's not because of queuing. That's because of something known as crowding. And here's the basic phenomenon of crowding. So if you fixate this top plus, then assuming you're not sitting too far to the sides, you should find it relatively easy to see the V on the left, right? But if you flank it with nearby clutter, then it becomes considerably harder to read that V, right? You all see that? But if you move the clutter away from the V at some, people call it the critical spacing, it becomes easy again. Becomes easy to read the V in the center. All right? This is known as crowding. It's basically just saying that peripheral vision is very sensitive to clutter. And just this is really the big fish in peripheral vision. And here's one way of seeing it. Here I'm now plotting the fit to some data for grading acuity, whether you can tell that a grading is a grading versus like a flat, you know, thing with no variation in it. So it's essentially the thing I started out saying, whether these are two bars or one bar. That's in the blue curve, and you can see that increases only very modestly with eccentricity. The green curve is how much you have to increase the letters with eccentricity to have equal difficulty telling what the letters are. And this critical spacing and crowding goes up much faster with eccentricity. So that's a much bigger effect. And people initially studied this a lot with letter arrays, but it is applies to stimuli in general, anything that's cluttered, and usually the world is cluttered. So here, for instance, is a demo with a map. If you all fixate on the star, try to see where the kind of red, orangish-brown subway line goes. All right, and I think you'll find it's quite difficult to tell where that line is going. Keep fixating the star, and I'm going to remove the clutter. You can see it quite well, right? And in fact, you can even see the dashes on the line quite well, right? This is not an acuity thing. It's a nice sharp line off in the periphery. It's just hard to see in clutter. Okay. All right, so what the heck is going on here? What is peripheral vision doing that's making this happen? And over the last number of decades, a convergence of evidence seemed to point in a similar kind of direction. That even though you might be telling peripheral vision, hey, I want to know what that object is, off in the periphery, peripheral vision was instead doing some kind of texture processing. That form is lost, that you seem to get the statistics, but without having the kind of precise form information you needed to do some kinds of object recognition and so on. This is also referred to as pooling or compulsory averaging of signals. Again, trying to capture that idea that texture processing is thought to involve measuring a bunch of image statistics of the texture. All right. Now you might ask yourself, why would the visual system do this? Why would it do texture processing out in the periphery when you don't want to do a texture task? And one argument might be that it's to deal with limited capacity, but a different sort of limited capacity than the attention folks were thinking of. So it might have, for those of you who are computer scientists, it might have seemed like a strange idea that the way that you would get through a bottleneck would be to grab the boat and send the boat through, and then maybe grab, you know, the car and send the car through and stuff like that. If you're an image processing person, the first thing you would do to deal with a bottleneck, to deal with limited capacity, would be to compress the darn thing, right? You compress the image with like JPEG or something like that. And this texture encoding might be a way of essentially doing compression. So here's just sort of a demo. Suppose that you have this image, which is 280 by 280 pixels, and suppose I told you have to encode it with only, say, 1,000 numbers. Okay? Well, one thing you might think of doing is just to subsample, maybe a bit like a retinal strategy. So you might encode a low-resolution version. Okay, great, that's 1,000 numbers. And it's not great for a lot of tasks, right? You can tell pretty precisely where things are and maybe kind of guess that they're black things against a gray background, but you don't know much else. Now, you might say, how about if we make some more complex measurements first? We're going to do like V1-like measurements, orientations at different spatial scales, and then subsample. Well, that also doesn't look so great. So also not a great idea. On the flip side, if you instead measure a bunch of texture statistics, and then you can do much better. And here I'm using texture statistics from Mortini and Cinicelli, a state-of-the-art model of texture perception. And it's a whole bunch of different statistics. There's a bunch of marginal things, like the mean luminance and stuff like that. But a lot of the statistics are basically joint statistics of oriented V1-like cells. So it's encoding things like, if you've got vertical stuff, do you have horizontal stuff nearby? If you've got vertical stuff, does it continue into more vertical stuff? And statistics like that, these kind of joint statistics. And if you do that, you can actually synthesize a new texture using their technique that has the same statistics as the original, but is otherwise random. And if you do that, you can see that an awful lot of information is encoded in just those texture statistics. You can tell that they're letter-like things against a black letter-like things against a gray background. And the main cost, and you can tell what some of those letters are. This is a particularly good example. In many cases, it's not nearly this good. But you can even tell what some of the letters are. And the main cost is this kind of loss of position information. So for instance, you'll notice there was a Q in the bottom before. Now there's an X in the bottom. So you're going to make some errors. Okay, so then the bigger picture model here, which we call the texture tiling model, you give it an image and a fixation, you lay down these pooling regions. The pooling region size is going to have something to do with the critical spacing of crowding. Within each of those pooling regions, you're going to measure a bunch of these image statistics. Oh, and I should say, since some people have been unclear on this in the past, the idea is that these pooling regions are sparse, they overlap, they tile the visual field, and they grow linearly with eccentricity in these pooling regions. Yeah?
So do the pooling regions scale with the density in the density plot, or is it different?
The density plot, which plot?
The Rodin plot.
There are arguments that if you know the acuity at any given eccentricity, you can predict the size of these things, and there's still some arguments, but that's not a bad first approximation, let's put it that way. And I should say, by the way, we're also doing kind of a somewhat crude removal or high spatial frequency in the model as well. Okay. All right, so how do we test this model? So I sort of hinted at the methodology before, which is, you know, I showed you this original image, and I showed you this one that was blurred to mimic the loss of resolution, and I argued that you can just look at this and tell that you do a lot of tasks with that information, right? And so similarly, we can use texture synthesis techniques to mimic the loss of information due to this encoding scheme. And you can first of all just get intuitions about what kind of performance you would expect if that's your encoding. And so you start with an image and start with a fixation, and you can generate these new images that again are similar local statistics but are otherwise random. Friedman and Cinicelli also do this with a very similar scheme. And you can do this for every given fixation and image. You can do this actually multiple times. And you can first of all just look at them and see what kind of information is preserved. So for instance, if this is the original and these two are, we call these mongrels, tell me what task, what do you know about the scene just from looking at these two? What kind of scene is it?
Bus stop.
It looks like a bus stop, that's right. Sorry?
High-rise buildings.
Vehicles. There's trees. How about like here?
People.
There's people standing there. Now, you might not know some things about like the details, like how many cars and stuff like that. And you're not going to be reading much of that text, although you can maybe make a guess at that. Looks like road, probably, right? But anyway, so you can see that an awful lot of rich information is preserved, but on the other hand, maybe not enough to be really good at like change detection if you change a little thing off in the periphery. Point at? Okay, so first of all, you might like to know, is this actually even a good model of peripheral vision? Among other things, we've run a bunch of crowding tests at this point. Each one of these images down here shows a different condition that we ran. In this case, the target was always one of four letters, F, E, L, or T. It's flanked by other letters, by boxes, by toasters, and things like that in some cases. And each one of these points up here is corresponds to one of those conditions. And I'm always showing you the model prediction here versus the human. The model prediction comes from, I should have said, what we do in practice to get quantitative predictions is we actually have people look at these mongrels like this and actually do tasks with those mongrels, and we can measure their performance. Okay, so that's what's along the x-axis. Y-axis is the human performance and peripheral vision. And you can see that it's quite a nice fit to the data. And I should say, by the way, there's a parameter-free fit here. This is, this is not a mere correlation. There's an actual prediction, a quantitative prediction of how hard the task will be in peripheral vision. Here's some other tasks. Again, each one of these dots corresponds to a different condition. And again, the fit is pretty good. This data here is from Cheyenne Keshvari, who's sitting right back there waving at us. And again, looking at a whole bunch of different conditions off in the periphery, where you're asked to identify the central item in an array. At this point, by the way, we've tested more than 70 conditions with this model, which is essentially unheard of for human vision models, to my knowledge. And it does well on quite a lot. Okay, so that's just like crowded object recognition. To what extent can we, with this one model, explain both the impoverished vision that we get in some experimental conditions and how rich our percept is of the visual world? And so one thing we looked at is search. Here on the x-axis is the model prediction. How hard is it to discriminate a target present from a target absent patch in the periphery? Here on the y-axis is, again, search performance. And you can see it's a pretty darn good fit, pretty good prediction of how hard search is. You could also imagine, just by looking at these things, that you would have an awful lot of information to tell you rich things about the visual world. And we've done this quantitatively. So we've asked a whole bunch of different people fixated in the center of the scene, and they're asked a whole bunch of things. Some of them are object recognition tasks, like is there a bike, is there a stop sign? Some are, is there a left turn coming up, or does the road just go on straight? Is this Paris, is this Los Angeles? A whole bunch of different scene tasks. We were trying both to get a real richness of tasks and task difficulty, and we also, like an awful lot of has been things like, is there an animal in the scene? We wanted to aim towards a little more naturalistic. And again, each one of these symbols is a different task. They're color-coded according to the kind of task. And there's certainly, as in the previous graphs I've shown you, there is variance left to be explained, right? But nonetheless, it does do a pretty good job of predicting the performance of the fixating human on these tasks. And here's just a demo of a change blindness example. Here's two pairs of the change detection. The circle is not there in the original task. The difference is that an engine appears and disappears in this pair. And then here, these two are mongrels where we modeled fixating about 5 degrees away, which is beyond the threshold. So humans had a hard time doing the task at this eccentricity. It sure looks darn hard to tell which one has the airplane engine, right? If you go closer to the threshold, which is only about a degree of eccentricity away, then it's quite easy to tell which one has the engine, and you do quite well. We actually have done this for all the change detection pairs at this point, and we have quantitative data, but I don't have a graph yet. But it doesn't, but it looks good. I forget, we're explaining like 40% of the variance or something like that, so it's a bit more noisy, but it's pretty good. And I think that makes sense, because there's clearly components of change detection that are things like, where do you decide to look, and, right, okay. All right, so the classic attention story was problematic for a number of reasons, right? And again, the story was that without this early selective attention, your vision was just poor. The selective attention itself was limited, both in terms of the number of tasks you could do at once and the number of things you could attend to at once. And you couldn't just fill in the details with memory because that was limited, right? And we asked, you know, how is it that you can, it was relatively obvious how you could predict the poor performance of that model, but how could you also predict how good we were? And how could real-world vision work in this kind of scheme? But now with this summary statistic encoding in peripheral vision, there seems like there's hope for a more coherent explanation. So the idea is you can have some sort of hierarchical strategy for analyzing the incoming image. At some stage, there's this pooling over these overly large regions. That's like computing some kind of summary statistics. You lose information, and that can explain, to a first approximation, how hard search is and how easy scene perception often is, and change blindness and peripheral object recognition and so on. I haven't presented it here, but it also turns out the same model can we've also looked at, it seems that peripheral vision is at least a factor in dual task performance, and I'll say something more about that in a second. And it also seems to be a factor in inattentional blindness. Like I showed this frame before from this inattentional blindness where the gorilla walks through the middle of the basketball scene, and it also seems like peripheral vision is at play there. And this is really exciting, I think, because for the first time, there's a unifying account of these tasks that you're bad at and the tasks that you're good at with this one model. And it's also worth noting that with this kind of information available across the field of view, presumably in parallel, this need for attentional capture or whatever isn't necessary. This is your original image, and this is the information that's available when you're fixating on that book fair. You've got a lot of information to help you know, first of all, just what kind of scene it is, and even some of the objects in the scene. You've got plenty of information to notice that this painting is salient, and maybe it would be interesting to go look at it. You've got plenty of information to know where the desk is, and so on. You may just have to move your eyes a bit, guided by this rich information, in order to find the bug. And again, we really do need to rethink this early selective attention as a result of this. Before, the selective attention story seemed to be good at explaining what search tasks were easy and what ones were hard. It seemed to be good at explaining why at least some change detection is hard and why you get illusory conjunctions, meaning, again, you see a white vertical as a black vertical. Why you're bad at hard dual task experiments. And there's also this disorder where you have a stroke and you have something called balance where you also get these similar kinds of things with illusory conjunctions and difficulty doing search and so on. On the other hand, it was problematic because it was hard to explain scene, getting the gist of a scene easily and getting the gist of a set easily. And also your sometimes search is easy and it can't be explained by the attention story, and sometimes change detection is easy and that can't be explained by the attention story and so on. And at the very least, we've got to say that an awful lot of this evidence in favor before had this massive peripheral vision confound, so we have to rethink what that evidence meant. And in other cases, it's clear that peripheral vision at least partially explains what's going on. So those, for instance, are ones that clearly have some confound, and the one with the smileys, peripheral vision can at least do some of the job, right? So we really need to rethink this. And one way of putting this is, you remember this picture from before, I said some people have suggested that you have this other pathway that does this non-selective processing. And you might recall also that I said that this non-selective pathway was for doing scenes and sets, and that a lot of people talked about it like maybe it didn't do ordinary object recognition. Instead, it did some kind of like statistical encoding or something like that, right? And that by now should sound kind of familiar, right? That's what I've been talking about, some kind of efficient encoding by summary statistics, in our case in peripheral vision. That sounds an awful lot like what people were saying for this non-selective pathway. And in fact, whereas the old feature integration theory put all the hard tasks up here, attributed them to the need for attention, and the easy tasks like scenes and sets were due to this non-selective processing, we can now do it basically all with the non-selective processing. That's what I've been showing. So it might be that it's not clear what you need that other pathway for. We need to rethink that. Okay. However, you might recall that I originally had this big list, and I've only talked about like set perception. I've only talked about search and change blindness, and the other easy things like scenes and sets. So what about these other tasks? And I want to go back to them as a way to ask, in rethinking what is going on, let's look at the evidence for what kind of extra component we might need. And so here's some of the there's experiments here. We had multiple object tracking and visual working memory and dual task, and this is meant to be some set perception, it being hard to get an individual item. But mostly, let's concentrate on these. Certainly, it is true. You first might say, is there a peripheral vision compound in these experiments? And certainly, in some experiments, that was true. I mean, you can see multiple object tracking is almost always very crowded. Visual working memory displays often were very crowded. And there's almost always one peripheral task in the dual task experiments. That said, people have done this carefully, at least some experiments have been carefully done, so it's clear this is not just crowding. Okay, so that can't be the explanation here. And certainly, it can't be the explanation for why dual task is often harder than a single task. There's no peripheral vision thing that explains why that would be true, right? So a full explanation to include all these has to include some kind of additional capacity limits. And so we can ask what kind of limits and what are the associated mechanisms with dealing with those limits. And I have a recent paper and another one that's going to come out soon where I do some more speculation on what I think might be going on. Here, for the purposes of the class, I'm not going to speculate too much, but I want to point out some similarities between these remaining tasks that are hard. So take the visual working memory task, for instance. They maybe show you this display, and then they ask you, they show you this one or this one, and ask you, is it the same as the one that you originally saw? And you're supposed to say yes or no, and that measures how many items you can remember in the visual memory at the same time. And again, I mentioned that people think of this in terms of almost like a computer science kind of notion of memory, that you've got like places you can put information in your computer. And do you have enough space for one item to put into memory? Do you have enough space for two or three or four? And this experiment is intended to figure out how many items you can put in. But that makes a lot of assumptions about how the memory works in human vision, right? And it might not work like it does in a computer. So a more sort of agnostic way of thinking about what's going on here, forget about, you know, there being some number of slots you can fill. Someone is showing you an image, and then they're asking you to distinguish that image from all other images in which one of those items might have changed color, right? Now, if you had to do that with some kind of classifier, in some arbitrary space like, you know, the top level of your CNN or something like that, you could imagine that would be an awfully hard task to do. It might be a very complicated classifier. Put another way, you might imagine that, you know, vision develops to make real world naturalistic tasks easy, and it makes these hierarchical spaces in which, you know, cars are very different from dogs and stuff like that. But in a space like that, you could imagine that, you know, little arrays of eight disks of different colors are occupy this very teeny tiny space of images. It might be very hard to distinguish them. Okay. And we can make sort of a similar argument for multiple object tracking. Again, people have assumed that there's some number of attentional spotlights you can control, and the goal is just to find out how many of those spotlights there are. But again, that makes a lot of assumptions about how this is working. Let's pretend that we don't know that that's what's happening. A more, again, just like generic way of thinking of the problem is that at each time step, you have to distinguish between the, say, four items someone told you to track and the n choose k other possible four items that you could be tracking, right? And so, for instance, if they told you to track four of nine items, at any given frame, there's 126 possibilities for what the four targets are, you might imagine this is an inherently difficult task. Now, of course, motion will help you, so it's not going to be this incredibly difficult. But again, it sounds like an inherently difficult task. And you can also think about this in terms of dual task, right? If one of your tasks was to do animal, no animal, off in the periphery, and another task was to do all T's versus T's and L's, those might be nice, easy tasks on their own. But those are each two AFC, two alternative force choice. The dual task is inherently more complicated because you've got to distinguish these four different categories, animal and T's, animal and T's and L's, and so on. So this also might be inherently more complex, which is why dual task is often harder than single task. All right. And so you might imagine that inherently difficult decisions, anytime we start talking about inherently difficult decisions, that might suggest that the limits we're running up against are actually latent capacity limits, that there's some limit on how complicated your classifier can be at a given time, and you have to get around that by you use a simpler classifier as a result, make errors, and so on. So this is what this is my hypothesis. You have these losses in perception and coding, they explain an awful lot, and then you have additional limits there which might, speculating, hypothesizing, be able to explain a lot more. All right, so in conclusion. So I think that there's hope for a unifying model here, that the limits that we see in behavioral experiments might arise because of essentially two main factors, and that those main factors make at least these standard vision tasks very difficult. A big factor is losses in peripheral vision, in particularly due to crowding in peripheral vision and this lossy summary statistic encoding in peripheral vision. And the idea is that with a given fixation, you have a certain amount of information that's available and some information that's been lost. With that given fixation, some tasks will be easy and some tasks will be hard. If you need more information, you move your eyes. Whereas these late decision level, you might also have these late decision level capacity limits, where there's just a limit to how complicated a task you can do at once. And there, it's not so much that you change the information you have, but you can gain more understanding by doing a new inference task. You might have before been asking the animal, no animal, now you switch to an inference that's something about what kind of scene it is, and you get more information by changing your task. And I think it's hopeful that the same single model with these two components, an encoding phase and decision limits, could underlie both the limits of human vision and the power, how good we are at so many tasks. And that's it. Thanks.